Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Good evening, dear viewers. Hello and welcome. Dr. Mohammed Alsheef, your host of Elixir of Life, kicking off another inspiring and informative episode about effective communication skills with our distinguished guest, aiming to explore new frontiers and to bring you the most up-to-date information related to health. Elixir of Life, your best source of evidence-based medicine. We have many inventive and stimulating segments. Most importantly, our episode theme, effective communication skill. Stay tuned for a special episode. Once again, welcome back to Elixir of Life. Our next segment will be the quote of the week. Stay with us, don't go away. Once again, welcome back to Elixir of Life. This quote is highly relevant to our episode theme. We'll talk about it more. And now our next segment will be medical news. We'll be talking about 4th International Conference of Endocrinology and Diabetes. To watch more details about this report, stay with us.
And of course, right now we had the 4th International Conference of the First in Endocrinology and Diabetes, if I pronounce it right, with us here, of course, Dr. Saleh Al-Jasser.
Okay, first of all, I would like to thank Channel 2 of Saudi Arabian TV for having me with them today and sharing with us, you know, this nice event. This event is the 4th International Conference of Diabetes and Endocrinology, sponsored and organized by Saudi Society of Endocrinology and Metabolism, which is, you know, held in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. The goal of this conference, in fact, is to teach, to learn, to educate our healthcare professionals on the latest update in the field of diabetes and endocrinology. This, you know, update helps a lot of our healthcare professionals to gain the knowledge they need to provide the best care to our patients.
As you know, this is the 4th International Conference in Endocrinology and Diabetes. It includes many actually international speakers and regional speakers from the Gulf and Arabic countries, but also include local speakers, participant numbers, almost 1,500. There is also a lot of advancement in the diabetes management, for example. Now they are manufacturing the infusion pump. This is called a closed system pump. This pump are smart pump that the patient usually with type 1 diabetes, they fit it, and this pump will scan the blood sugar frequently, and the pump itself adjusts the dose of insulin instead of the patient. So there is no actual intervention from the patient, okay, usually in the management of diabetes in this pump. This pump actually great advancement in the management of diabetes, because blood sugar when come low, the pump will disconnect and will alarm the patient that blood sugar going down, so the patient will be careful about this issue. There is also a lot of advancement in the management of diabetes. There is manufacturing of new drugs like injections, subclasses of GLP-1 receptor agonist or glucagon-1 receptor agonist. That given once weekly. Also, there is advancement in the manufacturing of many new drugs for dyslipidemia And also there is update in many guidelines, various endocrine disease like thyroid carcinoma, like osteoporosis, and like growth disorders. Many changes or new guidelines were issued.
Shemari, consultant endocrinology, diabetes, King Abdulaziz Medical City National Guard. I'm assistant professor in King Saud University for health science in National Guard. Yes.
Now, due to recent research, have you uncovered any new facts about diabetes or anything like that?
Sure. The diabetes, as everybody knows, there is two type of diabetes, which is the type one is mainly there, mainly for children and or adult, but they are using insulin and insulin only injections. The other part, which is type two, which is the commonest part, is the adult type of diabetes. And they are using oral hypoglycemic agent, which is tablets, or they can use the injection. The new things about it is we're talking about the artificial pancreas, which is can be in the market soon. The injecting insulin through the machine to the body directly and can control blood sugar. But definitely it needs and cooperations with the patients to reach to that target.
Once again, welcome back to Elixir of Life. We hear a very interesting report about state of art advances in the management of diabetes mellitus. Now we'll go for the next segment. We'll be talking about health myth and fact. To watch more details about this report, stay with us. Again, welcome back to Elixir of Life. Now we are coming to the most important segment of our episode. It's the episode theme, Effective Communication Skill or Enhancing Physician Communication Skills. It's my great pleasure and honor to present my distinguished guest, starting by Dr. William Maples. He is a director of Healthcare Institute of Excellence and oncologist at Mayo Clinic. And our second distinguished and esteemed guest, Dr. Ali Aseeri, he is Executive Director of Patient Experience and Pediatric Gastroenterologist at King Fahad Medical City. Welcome, both of you.
Thank you very much.
Okay. I think our topic is very important, is effective communication. Effective communication between patient and physician or successful communication will lead to improved outcomes, patient adherence to treatment plan, and more satisfaction. Without further ado, we'll start by asking the first question to Dr. William about why is focusing on patient experience a critical element for the success of healthcare organization. We'll start by you and we'll pass this question to Dr. Ali as well. Okay.
Thanks. There's a nice quote by one of my colleagues that did work on this. It said that the future of your healthcare organization really depends upon the quality of the service or the experience that you create for both your patients and your fellow caregivers, your fellow physicians. What that really boils down to is the way that we actually show up and have our conversations moment to moment creates the culture of the environment that they're working in. And when you actually enhance the culture to one that embraces trust, one that embraces teamwork and demonstrates compassion, you actually drive all of the other mission critical things that that your health system is trying to accomplish. So by actually creating that right culture, you make everything else that you're doing succeed to get to your ultimate goals.
Very wonderful. Would like to reflect on this, Dr. Ali?
Yeah, organizations who adopt patient experience as their sort of model of care are trying to get back to the main purpose of healthcare. If you ask anyone who's in healthcare why you went to healthcare from the first point, I think the main aim is to help patients. So we consider patients as the reason for our existence, and this is the reason why we are in healthcare. So patient experience is simply trying to get back that purpose under focus. So we get everything from the patient and back to the patient. Patient will be the center of our care. So we consider their needs. We put them as priority. We ask them about our care. We take their concerns seriously. We put our systems based on what is best for patients. So this is simply the patient experience. Mm-hmm. And all aspects of care, we always try to see what patient needs and try to fit our needs. The patient needs will be the driver for our care.
Wonderful. So where did it start, this journey of patient experience? From the moment the patient entering the hospital or from the encounter with the physician? So
in fact, even it starts before.
Okay.
It starts from the first contact with the healthcare organization or system. Like, if the patient calls the organization asking for an appointment, this is an encounter that the patient will start having the experience about that organization. And sometimes even before that, when they go check, about that healthcare organization in the media, when they check about it in the research, about it in the search engines, that experience will start being formed at that moment. Mm-hmm. Because if there are, people talking positively about that organization, patients will come with a perception of good sort of perception and vice versa. Mm-hmm. So even before the physical contact with the healthcare organization, mm-hmm. the experience could start, even long time before that.
Very interesting, because I thought it's just entrance from the main gate and in the parking lot, that's the start of the patient journey or experience. But you have pointed out it's just start,
Mm-hmm. Even before that, a patient will come to you with already sort of formed initial impression based on what he has heard or she has heard about about the organization, whether it's positive or negative. So this is why organizations should make sure that, experience with their clients or their customers are positive, because word of mouth will spread about the organization, and if word of mouth is good, next patient will come with good impression. If it is negative, he will come with negative impression.
I think this question is setting the stage for our next important question. People, what's the most or the top, reasons for have patient satisfaction or positive patient experience? Is it the technology or state-of-the-art technology, or is the communication with the patient? I think that's leading us, what's the definition of effective communication? How we define it, Dr. Mabel?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I think I would break it down into a couple of components. First of all, how do we show up as a caregiver and in a, to deliver compassionate care? So to really do that, you need a couple things that are in your toolbox. So first of all, to be present, to really acknowledge the patient or your colleague, if you're talking to your colleague, and to try to let all other distracting thoughts, and that's really hard as physicians. There's so many things that are entering and leaving the mind every moment, but to really become present is the first skill in the toolbox. The second thing is the art of listening. How do we really listen to what our patients are telling us? It really creates a sense of respect, of mutual respect, and a deeper understanding. Listening to understand, listening to truly connect with that patient. The third and fourth skills are how we gather information. Sometimes as physicians, we think we know what we want to gather, and we gather the information that's important to us, which is important, but we can sometimes lose information that's critically important to the patient. So how do we do that in an efficient way? The next skill that's important in the communication is connecting. So all of us want to be able to connect, particularly when patients are vulnerable and are seeking care. They want to be able to connect and trust that their healthcare team. So what are the skills that are necessary to truly make those connections meaningful and build trust? And then the last skill that I think is absolutely critical is the ability to appreciate every member of the healthcare team. And I put the patient at the center of the healthcare team, but how do we really appreciate the patients for what they bring to the overall plan that we're creating? How do we appreciate our fellow physician colleagues, our nurses, our support staff, so that we truly do act like a team? Mm-hmm. Those are the things I think that actually create effective communication.
Mm-hmm. Very beautiful. Are they all equally important, or we can say we just will pick one, okay, and we will overlook others, or they build on each other?
You know, I think that they are well integrated and woven. We can think about them as separate skills, but in reality, we need to use each one of those skills at different moments, and as we really become efficient at them, they actually become integrated into our DNA, our own fabric of really how mm-hmm. we respond. But there's a need to tug and pull on each one of those skills at different times and put them all together.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Ali, why is it important to have effective communication skills?
Yeah, as just said by Dr. Maples, when the patient comes to the hospital, you know, yes, they need treatment, they need diagnosis, but they expect that this is sort of a given, because this is the what's expected from a healthcare provider. But what they want and expect also is something beyond only just the diagnosis and treatment, which is connection, which is communication, and when we say communication, it's sort of an umbrella that has a lot of skills underneath it, and this includes respect of their choices,
right.
Respect of their opinions, respect of their rights. That also has, you know, under communication comes, you know, recognizing their emotions and, you know, addressing them and considering them. And that comes also, you know, sharing knowledge with them and information. Under communication comes the sort of supporting them and helping them to go through or navigate through their illness, you know, especially if it is a tough one and long-term and devastating. So when we say communication, it's not just only one single skill. It has a lot of, it's sort of an umbrella, and a lot of that, you know, comes under communication. Many skills that needs to be used and tailored to the need of the patient. So this is the expectation of the patient that, you know, especially knowing that healthcare is sort of a field that deals with the most important asset for any human being, which is his or her health. So sort of care we provide should be parallel to the importance of the item that we deal with, which is health. So we should take it seriously. We should address the, as I mentioned, all the sort of communication components when we deal with patients.
Dr. Ali, is there any survey that what do patients value most about their physician?
Do you have any? This has been proved beyond doubt by research that, you know, patients, you know, they need, you know, respect,
okay,
dignity. They need to be listened to.
Excellent.
They need to have their concerns addressed. They need to have sort of information shared with them. Even some studies say even this is more than just having the diagnosis and treatment and the pills or the injections. Mm-hmm. And this is something, you know.
And easy to approach the doctor, easy to communicate.
Yeah, easy to approach or communicate or to listen to them. And so mm-hmm. these are, you know, and has been sort of proved by many researchers and studies that these are the needs of patients in different communities. It's not only one community. So this is a human need, okay, regardless of the where does that patient live or stay.
So they don't look for the dress or for the qualification. The most what they care about the how he connect, okay, human connection by respect, yeah, dignity, listening to, addressing their concerns, as you have highlighted. So this is the importance of the effective communication on the patient aspect. What about in the physician related to burnout? Dr. Mabel, can you enlighten us more about this important concept, emotional exhaustion and burnout?
It's another excellent viewpoint in terms of the power and the importance of communication. You know, burnout is affecting healthcare providers across the world. And as we learn more about this, we're finding that as burnout or physicians, caregivers being emotionally exhausted, feeling depersonalized with their care and their experience, that as that actually is increasing, we're seeing medical errors increase.
Okay.
We're seeing the satisfaction of patients as well as caregivers decline. We're actually seeing the mortality rates increase as burnout increases. So this is such an important factor that we address to help our clinical team to really prevent burnout, to recognize burnout, and to prevent burnout. And one of the most important things that we can do when we look at burnout, there's many causes. It is not a simple problem. But one of the most important things that from work that Dr. Brian Sexton has done at Duke University is the relationships that we have with our patients and with our caregivers. And if we truly can have meaningful relationships, which at the root of those is effective communication, that building that trust, that teamwork, if we truly can reach that, we have one tool to help prevent the rise in burnout that's been happening over the world. So it's a very, very important challenge that healthcare is facing during the upcoming 10, 15 years.
Mm-hmm. Maybe you have highlighted and brought very important point. If we look for medical errors and sentinel event, major event, where do lack of effective communication lie in the reasons? Is it top 10? Is it number one? Is it third? So,
And this data has been looked at very carefully in the United States by the Joint Commission and similar bodies, across the world. When you analyze the root cause for why serious safety events happen, things that nobody would ever want to have happen, when you look at the root cause, communication is usually in the top three reasons, no matter what study you look at, of why these events actually happen. The lack of communication, ineffective communication, different versions of the lack of being present, of showing up, being in a present, mindful state, are major contributions to the serious safety events that happen in medicine.
Very important. I think we'll move to the next question that's very important. How do effective communication skills impact safety for the patient and caregiver and delivery of efficient healthcare?
Yeah, very important question, Dr. Mohammed. As we said, effective communication, under that comes like sort of focus and presence, where the focus would be on that patient at that moment of time. Effective communication is having sort of good relation with the team and with the patient, building trust with the patient. So if that's not available, which is ineffective communication, it means that the physician at that moment or the healthcare provider at that moment is not focusing or not mindful with the patient at that time. So this is the right setup for the medical errors to happen. Or shortcomings of healthcare. The other thing is teamwork. If the team is not really communicating well between themselves and with the patient, there is also high chance for medical errors to happen, and this will affect the safety of the patient. So as mentioned before, all the items of communication, like information gathering also, if you don't give the patient the full opportunity to express and list their concerns, you may miss the most important concern that they have, then this will affect their healthcare outcome and affect their safety. So each component of communication, if not addressed, if not taken care of in a very efficient way, patient will suffer. Mm-hmm. And healthcare in general, and specifically safety of patients, will be endangered.
What about efficiency? Okay, is there any make difference efficiency?
Yeah, sure. So if there's proper communication with the patient, so it means that you will address the exact complaints or issues that the patient is having. You will not miss something. So you will pick up the issues. You will manage them on time. But if there is no effective communication and something is missed, patient will come after some time, either they will go shopping, mm-hmm.
other opinions,
which is waste for the healthcare, or let's say if a patient missed to be diagnosed, like having a tumor, for example, cancer at early stage, that can be treated. And if he's missed because there is no proper communication, he may come after some time with bad disease. So mm-hmm. the health of that patient is affected, and that will be more costly to the healthcare organization. And other examples also are similar to this one. So effective communication helps efficiency of care, because you will pick up the problems, exact problems patient is having, you'll address them at the right point. Patient will also, based on the trust that you have, based on the relation that's built with them, they will be compliant to the treatment, mm-hmm. so they will improve. No complications, no long-term problems. Diabetes will be controlled, hypertension will be controlled, so no future problems. So it has a huge impact on
efficiency. There will be joint patient and physician agenda setting rather than only physician-centered approach.
Exactly.
And I think we'll minimize the doorknob while the patient leaving the room, okay?
Yeah, if you address the patient concerns from the patient perspective, if you take them into consideration, if it's sort of bi-directional communication and patient felt respected and engaged, that will reduce the frustration of the patient. And the last moment, by the way, doctor, I remember that.
That's
by
important.
The way, I remember that. Yeah. Then another set of communication, another set in a busy clinic that will
and
be really costly.
Okay. Yeah. I think... It came to my mind very important question, because now we are passing through economic strains. Say somebody will argue, what's the business case for investing in effective, communication skills? Is it, Dr. William, can you?
Yeah, and I think, a lot of times, healthcare organizations, patients, the community may look at patient experience as just having a happy patient, but as has already been pointed out by Dr. Ali and our conversation, it is so much deeper than that. It affects the the safety, the safety events, the medication errors. Each time we have one of those errors, it's very costly to the patient. It's very costly to the healthcare system. It creates rework, and sometimes the costs are quite steep. Sort of giving one additional dimension to the efficiency piece, which contributes to the business piece. Think for a moment, if you're the patient and you're not really connected to your team, and you really aren't bought into the treatment plan. And let's say for a moment you were hospitalized and nobody really explained so that you could understand what that plan was. Are you likely, if you're not bought in and engaged as part of the team, to really follow through with the recommendations, and then compound that with not really knowing what the recommendations really mean? Then, so what happens then is that a patient will leave the healthcare system wherever they are without that understanding, without really knowing why they should be doing what they're doing, so they don't do it. And then what happens is their medical condition actually deteriorates, and they're back seeking care within the healthcare system. The waste that's created with that cycle repeating itself is incredible, and in and of itself will create an outstanding business case for really why to invest in communication.
Thank you, Dr. Mabel. Now we'll go for a brief report about Choose Your Words Will Change Your World. To see more details on this report, stay with us.
Sign.
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
Once again, welcome back to Elixir of Life. Actually, that report was heart-touching and was very, I will say, I cannot describe it. I'm speechless. Maybe we'll have more reflection in this by our guest. And same related question, how to connect with the patient? We know effective communication is a human connection. How we connect with the patient, okay?
So I'll share a couple thoughts, and maybe Dr. Ali will have a couple thoughts as well. Yeah, that is a very heart-touching video, and first thing is just changing slightly the message can change the meaning. And so my message to all my fellow physician colleagues across the world is that you're doing incredible work, and you do it well, and sometimes it's just a tweak of really how we say things, how we approach things, that makes a world of difference to our patients, to their families and to our colleagues. So what we saw there, or at least what I saw in the video, is a slight tweak of the words to really connect to the emotions of really what was happening to that man. And by connecting to the emotions and emotions and connecting our hearts, we end up with a totally different result. And that's what we're trying to do when we talk about making those trustworthy, compassionate connections to our patients and the team, and what that type of difference will really have on the overall outcomes of our healthcare.
Okay, very beautiful, okay, and wonderful. Dr. Ali, any reflection on this video?
Well, I think Bill said it all, but you know, I will also emphasize on the same issue from another aspect, which is, you know, we're responsible for our words, and we have to choose our words, you know, very carefully. Because, you know, one word, if not said in the right context, could have, you know, long-term insult and effect, negative effect on either the patient or any person that you are communicating with. Mm-hmm. So words sometimes can be, you know, more stronger than stones, mm-hmm. So we need to be very careful. Talking here about patient, yes. And we see it. You know, unfortunately, we see that some healthcare providers, they just throw words without thinking of their consequences on patients, mm-hmm. and you know, patient will not forget. So mm-hmm. it is mentioned that patient will not forget how you make them feel. Mm-hmm. So if you make them feel bad or sad or depressed or negative, any negative feeling, they will not forget it.
They will not forgive you also.
And they will not forgive. So mm-hmm. we have to be careful.
I think that's important. Words can build bridge to unexplored worlds, like build bridge between the physician and his colleagues and physician and sure. Patient. I think that's important, relevant to that one. Just patient might have bad news, like cancer. Just maybe you tell him, okay, you have cancer, okay, and you can tell it in other words. I think would like to hear from Dr. Mabel about what's the best way to break bad news to a patient, okay?
Yeah, it's, you know, that's a very, very important skill for every healthcare provider to have, because, you know, the truth of it is that it doesn't even need to be cancer. There are many things that are hard for patients to really hear, hard for each individual, you know, for us to hear, that doesn't even necessarily have to have the as steep of an impact as cancer has. And so how we approach that in a respectful way, in a way that actually brings the patient's wishes and understanding into the conversation, in a way that actually allows for a respectful, meaningful connection to the patient that really conveys you truly care about them and you really want to help them walk through this and support them in any way. To really merge all those together and be sensitive about how that news is going to be delivered, where it's going to be delivered, are all critical components. And that first skill of presence and listening is so critical. We really should not be thinking about giving difficult news to any of our patients if we truly cannot be with them for that moment. So those are some of the things that I think about when I think about giving bad news.
Is there any model or we follow, okay, for physicians, okay, because some of the viewers are from the healthcare, you know, professionals?
You know, there are several models that are available, and the model that we tend to focus on for the framework of giving bad news is called SPIKES, it stands for creating the right situation for the patient to receive the news in private, mm-hmm. Obtaining the perception, or P of SPIKES, the perception of the patient, inviting the patient to understand how much he or she or the family may want to know at that time, The K is for knowledge. That is really sharing the knowledge that you have as a medical expert with the patient or family. The E is empathy, and we actually broaden that out, and we have a mnemonic or a phrase that we use called relations that help us really create that connection with the patient. And then the S is that you're actually providing a summary or a plan for the patient at the end of delivering the bad news. And perhaps Dr. Ali could talk about relations, which is that piece that we use to create the empathy.
Okay, I think that's how to recognize the patient emotions and respond appropriately.
Yeah, well, we have what's called relations, and it's really an excellent tool or framework that you could use in, with patients, especially if they are passing through sort of like emotions, tough emotions. And we know patients, they could have a variety of emotions, either anger or denial or frustration or sadness or different kinds of based on the scenario or the situation. So it's very important skill that the healthcare provider recognize that patient is passing through that emotion, and the response should be or can be with relations. So relations stands for R, respect, and then empathizing with patient, legitimization. Legitimization means that you acknowledge that yes, these feelings are genuine from the patient, and if anybody is in that situation, he could or she could have behave in the same way.
How to say it? Legitimization.
Legitimization.
How to say it? Is there any special sentence?
Yeah, you could say, I really appreciate what you are passing through, and if I'm in the same position, I would, or somebody else in the same position or situation, you could have showed the same feelings. Mm-hmm. A is apology, and it's something that we don't practice, and I think I would encourage myself and my colleagues in different areas to apologize, not meaning that, we did something wrong or a mistake, but feeling that the patient is really, we feel sorry that the patient is passing through that that scenario or that situation.
Or delay investigations.
Regardless, delay investigations and diagnosis, even if there is no delay, but he is suffering from that disease. So we feel sorry for that. So this is apology. So R A L A T is
trust.
So building trust is part, very important part of the relations, and that comes with the if the patient feels that we are really from the previous aspects. If you are respecting, if you are sharing knowledge, if you are legitimizing the feelings, if trust will come with that. So this is very important. Then the I, it's the
integrity,
which is trying, you need to make the patient feel that you're really here to help and you're available for them, and you're doing it from real, genuine feelings that the patient needs your support and help. CIO,
openness.
Which is openness. Openness means that you need to share, you need to have, don't hide anything. Be open with the patient. Ask what they need to know and share with them whatever about that case.
Transparency.
Be transparent. Ask what else. What issues are bothering you? So those sort of. And naming, which is you need to understand, recognize, and name what the patient is passing through. I see that you are frustrated.
Okay, naming that.
Exactly, naming the fear. I see that you are sad. So because that will connect with you, because they know that you are really focusing on them, you are present with them, you are really appreciating what they are passing through. Then S is support, strategy and support, and trying to, because during that time, patients will need support. Support could be different ways, helping them navigate through that difficult situation, will be considered support. So I think these are relations, and it is really working. And that can be, you know, by the way, not it's not only specific for the medical field. It's not only specific for the physician-patient communication. It can be used between colleagues, either physicians or physicians-nurses, or between nurses or any other healthcare professional. It can be used in life, in mm-hmm. our life, with
family,
you know,
okay.
family, with friends. With, so it is an excellent tool, and I think everybody should try to apply it.
So recognizing the emotions and responding with the relations, it will break the tension or deflate exactly. the tension with the patient.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have difficult passing through difficult conversation. If we implement the relations, okay, which we can, okay, down calm down the patient, and patient might have different okay behavior. Sure. I think that's important thing, that because we do have, and if we break bad news for patient badly, they will not forgive us, and if we break it exactly. in well, they will not forget us. They will be really appreciating for us. I think now we are going to, after implementing, you know, effective communications, what are the metrics to follow up, okay, to monitor improvement and stuff? Okay, Dr. Mabel, can you comment?
Yeah, sure.
On that?
I think there's a if we really follow the journey of our conversation here, I think the metrics kind of will fall out of that. So we talked about the actual experience metrics. So you can, Dr. Ali mentioned early on that you can actually measure patient experience. So what is happening to key experience metrics? What are the patient's perception of teamwork, the patient's perception of safety? You can measure what's happening to the experience of your fellow physicians, your physician engagement and experience. You can measure the experience that's happening with your support team, your nursing mm-hmm. and your allied health support team. And then when we get into the safety, there are multiple safety metrics that you can measure to really see what's happening in terms of how safe you're delivering care. We talked about efficiency. So there are readmissions where people come to the hospital or to the health system for a given reason and have to re-enter because of their condition not being controlled. Some of that is due to ineffective communication. So you can measure some efficiency metrics as well. Mm. So it's really a composite that you can look at. And lastly, and I don't want to lose sight of this, you actually can measure caregiver burnout. You mm-hmm. can measure a caregiver's capacity to show up at the bedside or in the office with empathy, and you can measure their emotional exhaustion and if they're feeling depersonalized. And so we should be keeping an eye on all of those as we really try to improve the communication throughout our healthcare organizations.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Mabel. Now we'll ask Dr. Ali, what's the best way to introduce and implement communication skills? Is it only by didactic lectures, or there is, a way to deliver it?
Yeah, you know, communication is skills. This is okay. what's called communication skills. And you know, skills and behaviors to be changed or improved, it needs to be sort of practice. You need some sort of didactic and some lectures, but this shouldn't be the main part. It should be only up to the point of just indicating why it's important, why that skill is important, how to do the explanation, but most of the time should be spent in practice. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, the doing the skill will make it stick more with the trainees or participants. So I would recommend that any communication skills improvement training should be composed mainly of practice and practice and practice.
Skill practice in addition to didactic lectures.
Yeah, didactic should be just the minimal part. Most of the time should be dedicated to practice.
Is it small group, large group, or?
Well, yeah, the more, or the smaller the group, the more chance for the participants to grasp, because they will have sort of a more chance for practice. If it is a large group and you know you cannot make everybody practice, so observing somebody practicing is totally different from practicing myself. So this is why I think I highly recommend for any successful communication skills training program to have small group practice, skills practice.
Dr. Mabel, I mean, you have been in this journey for a long time, okay, and you have achieved remarkable achievement and accomplishment. What were the main, you know, barriers for the success of this program? Because we are going to implement it in Saudi Arabia, we'll hear from Dr. Ali as well.
Well, first of all, I want to highlight what Dr. Ali just said. The skills-based experiential practice is critical, and he couldn't have said it, you know, more beautifully. In terms of the barriers, I would say I'll put it in two buckets. One is actually engaging the physicians in this work. Engaging the physicians not only to say we agree it's important, but we are going to help lead this work, and giving them a platform to lead this work. As we think of healthcare, the physicians, by definition, are leaders of healthcare. And if we're thinking about really creating a culture of teamwork and trust and support, we have to have our physicians be leading that work. That has been a challenge. For many years, healthcare organizations have put on their strategic plans patient experience, but we've magically left the leaders of the healthcare system out of the equation. So to figure out a way to engage the physicians in meaningful work that they can see immediately what's in it for them so that they can become the best clinicians they can be is the first barrier that has to be crossed. The second barrier, I said there were two buckets, is the understanding of many of the questions you asked about how communication affects the outcomes of our patients, the safety, the efficiency, and you phrased it in the sense of a business case for medicine. But to truly believe that an investment in communication will drive that is the second major barrier. And then to support it, both from a leadership perspective and financially. Now, one last thought on that. When you look at that return on investment, the business case, if you can understand those initial concepts, it becomes an easy no brain thinking situation, because the benefits are overwhelmingly positive.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Mabel. Now, we just would like to have take home messages in nutshell. Would like to brief take home message from Dr. Mabel and Dr. Ali Aseeri. Okay, can you just?
So my take home message would be that if we're truly going to create value in our healthcare system, providing the best care to every patient every day, and we truly are going to have concerns for our caregivers, that their well-being is the best that it can be, that they can go home each day with a good tired, that the key to that success is going to be investing in communication skills for our healthcare team, led by physicians.
Wonderful point. Dr. Ali, your take-home message in a nutshell?
Yeah, well, my message is to leaders. Unless they're really convinced and engaged in the importance of communication skills, it will not succeed. So please, as a leader in healthcare organization, make sure that you do all efforts to improve communication skills if your physicians and other team.
Thank you, Dr. Ali Aseeri, Executive Director of Patient Experience Administration. And thank you, Dr. Mabel, Director of Institute of Healthcare Excellence. It was very insightful and phenomenal interview. Thank you for being with us. I really appreciate that.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Now we are going to the last segment of our show. It will be health benefit about banana. Welcome back to Elixir of Life. Now we are coming to the end of our show. I wish you have enjoyed watching our episode and found it useful and motivating. Would like to thank our team, cameraman Ahmed Al-Ghatani, Salim Al-Uraibi, Diko, Tamer Al-Turiki, sound Mohammed Al-Ghasim, prepared by Rahab Al-Khaliti, presented by me, Mohammed Alsheef, assistant director Firas Kinani, and directed by Abdullah Al-Wulai'i. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.